invite for Wesleyan Church. If you're gathering here or watching sometime today, just be mindful that God loves you and we love you too. Hopefully you're energized. Anybody here energized this morning? Anybody at all? Three people. Three people are ready for a great morning, excited about what God has in store for us today. You know, sometimes we drag ourselves into church, and what a difference it makes when we come with wonder in our heart. I wonder what God has in store for me today. I hope that you prayed that and said that as you came in this morning. We never go away disappointed when we come with that right thought. Maybe you've had a rough week, maybe you've had a tough time, but when we come with wonder and excitement, God always shares with us something. I share with you one of my favorite verses is found in Psalm 118, and you know it by heart, I'm sure. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. This day, right now, it's all we have, isn't it? No guarantee of anything outside this moment. Yesterday is behind us, and tomorrow is the future. We have this moment. So what if this moment Jesus decided to return? Wouldn't that be great? Wouldn't that be awesome? In the moment of while we are worshiping him, he decides to come. What a blessed timing that would be to find us worshiping and listening and in a moment engaged in song and communion together. I really do. I've prayed many often as John had prayed in Revelation, even so Jesus come. Come, come quickly, Lord, come. And in the meantime, though, we wait and we pray and we stay ready, don't we? You know, that verse in Psalm, not only my favorite, one of my favorites, but the next verses are equally as important. Verse 25 in that Psalm 118 says, it calls on the Lord to save us. In fact, it says it twice, save us, save us. The emphasis there, twice in one verse, save us. In other words, there's no way we can do it on our own. Salvation comes from no other where but from the Lord. And then the very next verse says, blessed is he who comes. Put those two together. Blessed is he who comes to save us. Maybe you've heard of that word before. It's the word Hosanna. Do you remember when else it was proclaimed, Hosanna? In the New Testament, wasn't it? When Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem to be crucified, the people lined the streets. And they yell out, Hosanna, Hosanna, the one who's come to save us. They were literally proclaiming Psalm 118, verses 25 and 26, as Jesus rode by them. Now, I don't think that they really understood what Jesus was there to do. They wanted him to become their king. But Jesus was there for a different purpose, wasn't he? To save you, to save me, to become the king of our lives. Become the king of our future, the king forever. He was there to set us free from our sins, and only he's able to do that. And that's why we ought to sing loudly this morning, Hosanna, Hosanna, the one who has come to save us. He is worthy. He's the only one, the God of all wonders, the Alpha and Omega, the God who saves us. Let's stand together and let's sing Hosanna.
We turn to you. Hope is stirring. Hearts are yearning to you. We long for you. Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. We turn to you.
stars beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy. God of wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy. Lord of heaven and earth. Lord of heaven and earth.
To the Lord of heaven and earth. Hallelujah. To the Lord of heaven and earth.
Let's pray together. Father God, thank you so much for this day that you have made. God, you are a God of wonders. As we look around this great world that you've created, many things that seem naturally existing, created by your hand, God. A painting of your glory, of your power. God, and in each person's life who chooses to follow you, a beautiful tapestry of your glory, God. God, we just thank you for being a God of wonders. Every day, another amazing thing, another incredible thing that you do for us, God. God, I just thank you that you continue to get better every day as we follow you and walk in your ways. God, we just lift you up during this time, that this moment in time would be fully and only devoted to you, that our hearts would be open, our ears would be open to what you have to say today, God. God, we offer you our praise this morning, and we're prepared to receive whatever you have to pour out on us. God, we thank you for this time together. Amen.
God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy.
Oh, tell him this morning, God of wonders.
God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy.
Lord of heaven and earth. Lord of heaven and earth.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you so much. Woo! Well done. Amen. What a way to start off a service. Guess what? We get to continue to worship, whether it's through music and song or prayer or anything like that, or even announcements. Woo! Whoop, whoop. All right. Good. I want to share with you guys just a couple things that are going on. My list is short. I will do my best to keep it that way, but we'll see. So first of all, in your pews, connection cards, talk about them all the time. Just a great way for you to stay connected, update your information with us so that we can tell you what's going on. That's all we use that for. Send you out text message or email or call just to let you know things that are going on. So if you fill that out, you can put that in the connection card box on the welcome center, on your way out. And on the back of that is an opportunity to share your prayer requests, your praises, any way that God is speaking to you today. We'd love to hear those things as well. So we do encourage you, to fill those out if you'd like to and get those turned in as well. So, couple things that are going on every week that I just want you guys to know about in case you don't know. Sunday school has been going on for a few weeks now, 9 a.m. on Sunday morning. If you're really looking for that small group connection time, most of our classes are structured that way to spend some time getting to know each other, to go through the Word of God together. So if you're looking for those closer connections, Sunday school is a perfect opportunity for that. And we encourage you to ask. If you don't know what class fits you best, we will put you in the right direction. We have options for all ages. So please let us know if you're interested in joining Sunday school, or you can just show up. That you're allowed to do that too. Wednesday night, 6:30, kids, teens, adults, every Wednesday night. So we encourage you to be a part of that as well. Again, another opportunity just for a little bit more. It's a great way, I think, to cut the week in half. And you got Sunday and Wednesday, get a little refuel and finish the week out strong. So we do encourage you to join us for that as well. So a couple things that are going on today. I've been announcing it for a couple weeks. And obviously today the weather is not operating and acting as we would like it to. But we are planning on doing trunk or treat. We're going to make a decision pretty soon here. We kind of are playing with the idea of postponing it just because today is kind of gross. So we will try to make a decision as soon as possible and get it out to you. But otherwise, 6 o'clock tonight out in the parking lot, we'll be doing trunk or treat. We've put out the flyers to the people at Whiteford Schools and all that stuff. So we will let you know as soon as that decision is made, probably as we keep looking at the radar and all those kind of things. But plan on being here. If not, don't throw away your costumes. Don't throw away your decorations for your trunk. We will postpone it, find another day that works well, and we will do it then. So if you've already planned that, and if you're thinking, oh my gosh, I didn't know this was going on, this may be great for you, because if we postpone it, you have an opportunity to think up an even greater costume and decorate your car even more. When we do it, whether it's today or in the future, there will be a prize for the best decorated trunk, so we do encourage you to work on that. Without the normal Fall Family Fest activities today, we're starting at 6, so if you get in whatever, if we're running about 5 o'clock, we'll get everybody set up so that when people start lining up, we're good to go. So plan on being here for that. I was going to say something else. I forgot. A couple things that are coming up. Kids Christmas musical. This lost me for a second. What month is it? October? That can't be right. This year's gone slow and fast at the same time, so I don't know what's going on. But November 1st, we're going to start Kids Christmas musical practice with Pastor Rick. I'm sure he's fully prepared for that and ready to do that. I'm sure he's going to be. But any child, kindergarten through fifth grade, listen, we've had some monsters up there. That's okay. We had the chickens that one year. They were fine. We got some crazy stuff. But we just need as many kids as possible. Pastor Rick will give them a part. He does a really good job of finding ways to include everybody. So any amount that we can get, the more, the better. He has a lot more leeway if it's not like a one-man show or something. So encourage you to invite. If you have friends who have kids in that age who want to be a part of the music or the Christmas musical, please let us know and bring them. He's going to start on Sunday nights at 5 p.m. Starting November 1st. Next Sunday, I mentioned it last week, but Aiden was distracting me, so you may have missed it. Next Sunday, we're taking a special offering for the Venus family. If you don't know, Alyssa's been in Cincinnati. She got a transplant. Things are mostly going well, but there are some things that they need to watch. And it's safest for them and best for them, basically the doctor's orders, to stay down there. So they had to like get an apartment. They're doing all this. So there's added cost with that. So we just want to pour out some more love on them to take care of some of those costs. So next week, we're doing a special offering for them. If you plan on writing a check or bringing cash or whatever that is, just plan on doing that next week for them. A couple things just to keep in mind in the back of your mind. This is the front, the back of your mind. We are working on plans to get the toddler area opened up in a safe way. So you can start to think about that if you're somebody who's like, I got to get rid of this kid for an hour. That will be open in a couple weeks as we're working on that. Junior church also, we've had a couple in the last couple months. We're going to try and get back into the normal swing of that. So it'll be at least 2 or 3 a month. So make sure to be thinking of that. If you're somebody if you know people who aren't coming because that isn't available, let them know. We're going to start that back up probably in November. So make sure to notice that. So toddler, junior church, if you want to volunteer at either of those positions as well, if you want to work in the toddler nursery, is that right? Whatever, toddler room, or help out with junior church, let me know. We'll get you in touch with the right people. I think that's all I have. So I'm going to pass it over to Mark, I think, and he's going to continue to lead us in worship. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Pastor Ben. All right. Yeah. You've caught on. Let's read our verse for life together this morning. Ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. The one who seeks finds. And the one who knocks, the door will be opened. Matthew 7, 7 through 8. You know, our hymn this morning is Great is Thy Faithfulness. And you might initially think, what does that verse have to do with Great is Thy Faithfulness? But you know what? It has a great impact, because as we look back over our lives and the prayers that we have had and God's acting, we can say, Great is Thy Faithfulness. And that's exactly what the songwriter did. Often our songs are by an event, but this songwriter had written many songs, and he looked back over his life. He was impressed with God's faithfulness. And so if we look at it from our perspective, looking back on how God answered our prayers, we can see his hand. But you know what the great thing is? God doesn't have to look back. He can look forward. And he can make decisions for you based on what's going to happen. Isn't that amazing? And I love here another perspective that songwriter had in verse 2. You think about this. Have you ever just sat at night looking at the stars? And as I was reading this, I thought, you know, you look at the stars and the planets and the intricacy of it all. And then Lord sitting next to you says, I made that. That's amazing. Our God made that. What's his perspective? You think your problem's big? I made that. So we needed God's perspective. And the best way to do that is to sing our song this morning, Great is Thy Faithfulness. It's page 43 in your hymnals.
Great is Thy faithfulness, O God my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, Thy compassions, they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever wilt be. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, Thy hand hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to Thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness. More new mercies I see. All I have needed, Thy hand hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
All right, now pay attention here to verse 3. Man, pardon for sin and peace that endureth. His presence to cheer and to guide. And I like this, strength for today. And what bright hope for tomorrow. And the reason we have hope for tomorrow is because he already knows what's happening. That's our hope. And in his faithfulness, let's sing it together.
Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow.
blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Can you say amen to that this morning? You may be seated, and we have a vision moment.
Welcome to this week's Monday Minute with Fishers of Men. It is a delight for me to introduce to you our three new children here at Refuge Ranch. They've been with us for just 1 week, and it's exciting to get to know them. This is Jose. He is 12 years old. Alondra is 7. And Nico is 5.
Hola.
Thank you so much for your prayers and your support of the ministry that allows us to continue transforming lives through Jesus' love and His presence. May the Lord bless you.
From our ministry down in Mexico that we went and saw. Spent time with her, and I think she's up to like 18 kids now, and had so many more come through there. Your money goes to help her place down there, feed them and clothe them and educate them, all there at Refuge Ranch. This is my desire, to honor you, Lord, with all my heart, I worship you. All I have within me, I give you. All that I adore is in you. Lord, I give you my heart, give you my soul, live for you alone, every breath that I take, every moment I'm awake. Your way in me. This is my desire to honor you, Lord, with all my heart, I worship you. All I have within me, I give you praise. All that I adore is in you. Lord, I give you my heart, I give you my soul. Live for you alone, every breath that I take, every moment I'm awake,
Lord, I give you my heart, I give you my soul. I live for you alone, every breath that I take, every moment I'm awake. Lord, have your way in me.
Well, good morning, everybody. Thanks for allowing me that moment just to get myself all hooked up here and settled. So good to see you today. 2 Corinthians chapter 12 this morning to look at a few scriptures here. Two young boys were spending the night at the grandma's house. And at bedtime, the two boys knelt beside their beds to say their prayers. The youngest one began praying at the top of his lungs. Dear Jesus, I pray for a new bicycle. I pray for a new Nintendo. I pray for a new phone. His older brother leaned over and nudged the younger brother and said, what are you shouting for in your prayers? God isn't deaf. To which the little brother replied, no, but Grandma is. Oftentimes I think we pray and we wonder if God is deaf, because we do not receive an answer or the answer we desired. Yet we read, don't we, that if we call upon him, he will answer. So why does it seem that God doesn't answer our prayers? Jeremiah captured this thought when he complained to God. He said, you have covered yourself with a cloud so that no prayer can get through. Have you ever felt that way as you prayed? I have more than once, praying for something we really felt like was in God's will, and it didn't turn out the way we thought. It wasn't that long ago, a girl who grew up here in this church, part of our youth group, had a baby. The baby was very sick, and we began to pray about it. We prayed diligently for 5 days, and God still took that baby. I remember asking, God, this doesn't make sense. That's a prayer, in my eyes, that should have been answered. But over the years, I've come to realize that God is always at work answering our prayers, even the ones we're not sure of why he answered the way that he did or if he was silent. And I've come to realize that there's no such thing as unanswered prayer. You say, well, Pastor Rick, I've had prayers that I've been praying for years, and I have no answer for them. I take you back to the book of Job, one of the first books of the Bible ever written, I believe. Job responds by saying, you will pray to him and he will hear you. And you respond, well, yes, Pastor Rick, he hears, but does he respond? And so I take you to Psalm 91, where Moses says, you will call upon me and I will answer. And you say, yes, Pastor Rick, but how does he answer? Why is there silence often in my prayers? Years ago, I attended a church growth conference in Marion, Indiana, and the keynote speaker there was a Wesleyan man named John Maxwell, big-time preacher, evangelist, leadership guru, and he preached the following on prayer. And he reminded us that God always answers in four ways. He says God always answers one of the four ways. He'll either say go, or grow, or slow, or no. We like grow, or go. That's a green light. That means go for it. Opportunities abound. We like grow. In other words, maybe not right now. It's not the right timing, the right place, the right moment. You just have to wait. Slow means take your time, progress slowly. Wait upon the Lord to direct your steps. Don't run ahead of me. No means no, this is not right for you. It doesn't fit into my plan for your life. Go, grow, and slow, we seem to understand. It's easier for us to accept. But the no is harder. It makes us wonder why. Did we ask with the wrong motive? Did we ask outside of his will? Did we not have enough faith? Why does God say no? God has said no many times in Scripture. Abraham prayed that God would spare Sodom and Gomorrah, and God said no. They were still destroyed. Elijah prayed that God would take his life, and God thankfully said, no, I'm not going to do that. David prayed and fasted for a week, asking God to spare his son's life. His son still died. Habakkuk prayed that the people would not be punished by the ruthless Babylonians that they were facing. They were. The Hebrew people faced a moment like this. It's found in, you don't need to turn there, but Numbers chapter 14. And they have just come back from spying in the promised land. They sent out, you remember, the 12 spies? And the 12 spies come back, and 10 of them come back with a negative report. 2 of them come back with a positive report. And you remember, Moses relented and allowed them to go. The Hebrew people were already told, go possess the land. God was going to give them the land. But they had to go spy it out. And so Moses relented, let them go. They come back. 10 of them says, we can't do it. The inhabitants are too big. They're like giants. We're like grasshoppers. 2 of them, Caleb and Joshua, says, we can do this. God has already promised the land. 10 of the tribes say no. 2 of them say yes. And as a result of their disobedience, God says the following. Because you disobeyed me, you're going to wander for 40 years in the desert. Well, when the people heard that, some of them said, oh, well, we don't want to do that. We'll go take the land. God says, no. No, we're going to do it, God. We're going to do it now. And so Moses even says, don't do it. God said, no. But they don't listen to Moses. They said, no, we're going to go and we're going to defeat these people. And God says, if you go, the inhabitants are too strong. You'll be wiped out. And so what do? We're not going to listen to you, God. And so they go, and guess what happens? They get wiped out. You say, well, Pastor Rick, isn't prayer just a matter of faith? You know, if I have faith enough, then our prayers will always be answered the way we want. No, that's not true. The Son of God didn't get every prayer answered in the manner that he prayed. Do you remember that? In the garden, he prayed, let this cup pass by me. He did add, nevertheless, my will. Not my will, but thine be done. And I'm glad that God didn't answer the first part of that prayer, aren't you? Because if God answered it, there would be no cross. There would be no salvation. I'm glad God said no. There was a cross waiting for Christ. And that would be the turning point for everyone down through the ages. Hallelujah for that. And it'd be arrogant for us to assume to know better than God and know how he should answer our prayers. C.S. Lewis wrote the following. If God had granted all the silly prayers I've made in my life, where should I be now? Sometimes God says no, because his infinite wisdom and concern for our lives, he knows that what we're asking is just stupid. That's true. What we would want would only get us in trouble. When we seemingly do not have an answer, it's probably because God's wisdom is much greater than ours. The truth is that some of the things I ask for from God are not good for me at all. Years ago, Garth Brooks wrote a song, a country western song, and how he talks about how he ran into his old high school sweetheart at a football game. And he remembers how much he thought he loved her, and he prayed that God would give her to him as his wife. But now, she doesn't look as good to him. And the conversation is awkward. And he looks at her, and then he looks at his wife, and then he writes in his song, sometimes I thank God for unanswered prayer. He continues in the song to say, just because God doesn't answer doesn't mean he doesn't care. Some of God's greatest gifts are unanswered prayer. And I would only add one thing to that. I believe God did answer that prayer. He said no. He shut the door. He said no. And sometimes he had something better in mind for Garth, and Garth understood it later on. We don't like the word no. We hear it way too often as kids, don't we? No, no, no. And for the life of me, as a kid, I didn't understand until I had my own kids. I said no because my wisdom was much better than theirs. My knowledge is greater than theirs. So what happens when God says no? We've been talking about these shut doors. When God shuts a door in our life, what happens when God says no? I think one of the first things we need to do is just examine ourselves. The first place to look, to start, if we're not getting an answer, is to simply look within ourselves. David said, "Search me, O God, and know my thoughts. Try me and see if there be any wicked way." David wanted to make sure that there was nothing that ever hindered his prayers. No sin in his life. Because sin will hinder our prayer quicker than anything else. We want answers to our prayers, but we're not willing to release the sin in our hearts. We're not really willing to release the pride or the lust or the jealousy or the greed that we hide in our hearts. Too often in our prayers, we treat God like a genie in a bottle. We rub the bottle, we want him to jump out and grant our requests. But God doesn't just grant everything we want. He desires more than anything at all to have an intimate relationship with you. And when there's sin in your life, it breaks that relationship with God, and God has to say no. A few years ago, I've told this story before, I'm not going to tell the whole story. But a few years ago, I did something that, it's just me. I say some things sometimes without thinking about them. I invited a couple that I did not know, I met them at a funeral, but they were in need, and I invited them to stay with us without first checking with my wife. Bad choice. Not to mention, as they are sitting at our table eating supper, the husband turns to his wife and starts commenting on how good the food is and how much better it was than prison food. Not a good choice. Bonita's standing behind them, hands on her hips, going, "What in the world did you get us into?" And then bonehead me, as I'm following them upstairs to show them where to sleep, I make the comment. Now, I'll just tell you what I said. I said, "Just make yourself at home." I get back to the bedroom. My wife is standing there. Hands on her hips. "What did you just say?" "What?" Oblivious. What are you talking about? "What did you just tell them?" "Make yourself at home?" "No! Tell them to stay in their room." Oh my goodness. You know, I've thought about that story a lot. And I said something I really didn't mean. I didn't want them to make themselves, I was trying to be polite, but I didn't want them to make themselves at home. Think about that. You ever say that to somebody? "Just make yourself at home." But you don't really mean it. Do you want people going through your medicine cabinet, looking in your closets? You want them laying on your bed, going through your drawers, looking in your files? Is that what you really want? No way. Guests, there are some places in your home that guests are not welcome. Stay out. I don't want you in there. You stay in this room, stay in that room. You can go back and forth to that one. The bathroom's there. The bathroom, kitchen, that's it. No other place. That's the written law somewhere. But I said, make yourself at home. I think we treat God more like the guest with the rule rather than the Lord of our life. God doesn't want to be a guest in our home where he's only allowed in certain places. Bob Russell wrote in a book on prayer, God doesn't want to be a resident in your heart. He wants to be the president of your heart. The Lord wants to be Lord of every area of your life. every closet, every cabinet, every box. And when he's Lord of all, we can have confidence that he hears every prayer and answers them according to his will. James says that when we ask and God doesn't answer, in James chapter 4, it says, because we might pray amiss. We're not praying the right way. We need to examine ourselves first. And then secondly, when we pray, just trust. When God says no, that God has a plan. I'm not sure what God has in store for us. Some of our prayers may not be answered in the way we envision in this lifetime. Some of you are praying for physical healing, and you may never experience it. Some are praying for loved ones to come to salvation and leave this world not knowing. I can only point you to Isaiah 55 that says, my ways are not your ways, saith the Lord. My thoughts are not your thoughts, saith the Lord. My thoughts are high above yours and way above yours, saith the Lord. Now here in 2 Corinthians, I ask you to turn there. 2 Corinthians chapter 12. Paul is facing one of those moments where he's praying. He's praying diligently for a physical healing. We read in just about to verse 7 there that he's been buffeted by a physical ailment. He calls it a messenger of Satan that has come against him. We don't know what that physical ailment was. There's lots of speculation, handwriting, eyesight, other things that could have been. We're not sure, but he prays diligently. God, please take it away from him. Three times he prays, and three times God says no. And the last time he prays, he finally relents, and God follows up this way. Verse 9, my grace is sufficient for you. My strength is made perfect in weakness. In essence, the Lord was saying, you think you'll be more effective without your physical handicap, but in actuality, you'll be more effective because of it. Just trust me. And I love how Paul responds. It's the next verse. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses so that Christ's power may rest on me. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Mark talked about it just a bit earlier. The realization that God has a much bigger perspective than we do. He sees not only what has happened, he's going to see what will happen. He has the big picture. I love doing puzzles. You know what the best part about a puzzle is? Not the end. The best part about the puzzle is the picture. The picture. You have a picture of what that puzzle is going to look like. When you're putting together a puzzle and you see a piece and where's this? You get kind of an idea where it's going to go because of the picture. Have you ever tried to put a puzzle together without the picture? It's a chore. I have no idea what this picture is going to look like. I have no idea. You can kind of get an idea after a little bit, start to come into view. You get a little bit of maybe the daisies or roses or something. Maybe it's a garden scene. You're just not sure. Sky, you have no clue. Bit by bit, moment by moment, piece by piece. But God sees the big picture, doesn't he? He sees how everything works together for his good. One more thing. When God says no, look ahead. See further still. None of us know what lies ahead. None of us have the ability to see how things work. Our job is to keep praying, to keep seeking, to keep believing, and to trust. You never know what's going to happen. And once God takes us further still, I think we discover that God's no is often what I call a redirection. Let me tell you the story of Inky Johnson. Inky Johnson grew up in the west side of Atlanta to a single mother in his grandmother's house with 14 other people. His mother worked three jobs to make ends meet. Mom made sure that Inky went to church every week with her. They prayed regularly around the dinner table. Inky and his brother loved to play football, and with the other kids in the neighborhood, they would play football in the streets, tackle football in the streets, until it was dark. Inky's dream from very beginning in life, when he was just a little boy, was to be an NFL superstar
to make lots of money so he could get his mother out of poverty and buy her a new home. When Inky was just about just a young teen, maybe 10, 11, 12, somewhere there, a man came by his neighborhood and saw him playing football and his cousin in the street. And he came and asked him, "Let me talk to your mother. I'd like you to come and play football for us." But his mother didn't have any money, and so the man said, "I will pay for everything." The man turned out to be a very godly man, became one of the spiritual mentors in Inky's life. Inky worked very hard, and it seemed like God was answering his prayer, because after high school, Inky was recruited by the University of Tennessee to play the football there. He was a defensive back. He became a cornerback that made many tackles. He intercepted many balls. He recovered many fumbles. And by his senior year, Inky was projected to be one of the top 20 NFL prospects. He was going to be drafted. The top 20 lucrative NFL contract waiting, multi-million dollars at the end of his senior year. At the first day of practice, when Inky was just a freshman, he was introduced to the team's chaplain. And the team's chaplain said to him, "Inky, I want you to be part of a young men's group that I'm discipling here on campus. Would you come and be a part of it?" And Inky said yes. And for his years at Tennessee, he faithfully came to those meetings. He gave his testimony of his upbringing to church groups. He gave his testimony. He became part of the Fellowship of Christian Athletes. The second game of his senior year, they were playing the Air Force Falcons. They were winning the game, and it was near the end of the game, and Air Force was driving down the field, and the Air Force quarterback made a pass towards Inky's area. Inky ran to meet that receiver who had caught the ball, jumped in midair, collided with the team, with that player, went down in a heap, and immediately he knew something was wrong. He couldn't move. Little did he know that he had torn his subclavian artery and permanently damaged his arm. It was a life-threatening surgery. The team gathered around him. They put him on one of those spinal boards. They rushed him to the hospital, got him into surgery, and when he woke up, they told him, "We were able to save your life, but we were not able to save your arm." His dream of playing in the NFL was over. His father, who had been distant from the family right from Inky's birth, had come back into Inky's life and was there that night when he got hurt, when in the hospital. He heard what the doctors had said. And Inky's dad was not a believer. And in the hospital room, after the doctors had left, this is what Inky's father did. This is what he said. "How could God do this to you? All those prayers for nothing. What kind of God is that?" What do we do when God says no? But Inky's father made a decision that he was going to stand beside his son and help him heal. And so he stayed there with Inky for the next month, helping Inky in his rehab, took Inky to his discipling classes that were being held still. He took Inky to the Fellowship of Christian Athletes. Inky went to a church and told his testimony, even while he was still hurting. His father went with him all these places. He never would go inside. He stayed outside and listened. He watched his son. He listened to his son as he gave his testimony. And about a month later, as Inky was getting ready for bed, his father comes into his room and says the following: "You know what you have? I need that." And that night, Inky's dad became a believer. Would you give up a lucrative NFL career, to see your father saved? Would you go through a near-death experience to see a loved one become a believer? Inky says, and I quote, "It was worth it all. I would do it all over again. I would gladly give up everything for that to happen." One of the quotes Inky gives, "The beauty of life is that God puts us on His path, and that requires Him to say no to our way." Inky's verse is, "In all things, God works for the good of those who love Him and are called according to His purpose." God redirected Inky's life by saying no to something He thought was most important in order to give Inky something that was eternally valuable. Why does God say no? Because God knows what's going to happen, doesn't He? He sees, He has the bigger picture. He has a better plan than what we have in mind. And for all the millions and millions of dollars that Inky could have earned, to this day he would stand before hundreds, if not thousands, of teenagers and young adults across the United States and say, "It was worth it all to see my father become a believer." God says no because He has something different and better in mind. Let's pray. Father, some of us have come up against that brick wall at times in our prayers, wondering why You're not answering. And we wonder, like Jeremiah does, maybe there's a cloud, maybe there's something that's hindering. And we've looked inside of us and said, no, there's no sin there. Our faith is strong. But perhaps it's just that fact that God has something different, better in mind for us. And I pray for those of us who are struggling today with a prayer that have seen, we keep praying it. We keep believing it's going to get answered. And we know that in one of those four answers, go, grow, slow, and know, that You're at work somehow in all things to work out for our good. I pray You'll help us to just keep praying, keep believing, keep seeking, knowing that the God who hears our prayers is answering them in the manner according to His will and His purpose. I pray You'll just give us wisdom and patience as we wait upon You, knowing that maybe some of the things we're praying about will never be answered this side of heaven. And then we'll understand it better by and by. Remind us You have the picture. You see it how it all works out. And You've called us to trust You. Trust You. In Jesus' name. Let me give you this closing thought before we take communion. An anonymous poet wrote years ago, "I asked God for strength that I might achieve. He made me weak that I might learn to humbly obey. I asked for health that I might do greater things. I was given infirmity that I might do better things. I asked for riches that I might be happy. I was given poverty that I might be wise. I asked for power that I might have the praise of men. I was given weakness that I might feel the need of God. I asked for things that I might enjoy life. I was given life that I might enjoy all things. I got nothing I asked for, but I got everything I hoped for. I am among men most richly blessed." Isn't that good? We're going to close this morning with communion. Those who are in fellowship with the Lord and earnestly do repent of your sin, let's come now together, join in, and let's take communion together. Thank you. able to get out the bread? Everybody got the bread? Hold up the bread. Let me see it. That little cellophane sometimes is hard to do. Sorry. For those of us who... of our Lord Jesus Christ, broken for you, died on a cross for your sins. Let's take and eat together. The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ shed for you, forgiveness of sins, not only now, but forevermore. Praise be to God, to the Lamb of God. Let's take and drink together. Let's stand. And now, Father, we pray that as we leave, as we go, that you'll help us to be persistent, to keep going, to keep praying, keep believing, as you answer our prayers. Thank you for all that you've shared and done with us this morning. Now help us to take the good news. Christ is our Savior. God is in charge. We can trust you, believing you always have our best interest at heart and in mind. Always. That's the truth throughout your word, is simply to trust you. Help us to have a great day now, I pray. In Jesus' mighty name. All God's people said, amen. God bless you as you go.